Every year, schools, organizations across the world spend billions of dollars, billions, on educational technology. And what often results is putting the cart before the horse. Now, I am all for having technology in the hands of our learners, our teachers, our administrators, because I firmly believe that it can support and enhance learning. But I really refer back to this quote often from William Horton, and that quote is, unless we get instructional design right, technology can only increase the speed and certainty of failure. And that's what we see many times. You know, if we really want change, technology changes, but teaching, learning, and leadership have to change. There has to be the support in terms of building pedagogical capacity if we really want technology to live up to its lofty goals. And often, you know, I am asked to come into schools and districts to perform sort of triage because all the money has been spent on the devices, but there has been no job-embedded, long-term, sustained professional development for both teachers and administrators. And in many cases, you know, in some cases, you'll see a lot of effort goes forth in providing that learning support for teachers, which is great. But if the administrators don't have that same support, if they can't go in and provide that feedback, determine what constitutes purposeful effective use versus ineffective use, then you're not going to really see technology live up to the lofty expectations that have been set forth. So as we think about making purchases in the stuff, whether it's interactive whiteboards, devices, programs, there has to be a clear vision first and foremost as to why are we making this investment, how will it improve learning, and what metrics or factors will we use to determine if the investment is successful. And it really comes back to a concept that Tom Murray and I talk about in Learning Transformed is return on instruction. This concept of return on instruction is as we invest in technology, there should be evidence of improved learning outcomes for our kids. If not, why are we making the investment? Why are we spending the time? So as we think about the purchases, let's think about how we really build that pedagogical capacity. And it really begins with looking at instructional design. If we're going to make that investment, let's make sure we have a clear vision for A, how is questioning going to change? How are tasks going to change? How will student work change? How will assessment change? How will feedback change? And let's really put all those essential questions out first and foremost before we make the investment in technology. And if you already have it, that's great. Take that critical lens and ask yourself, well, what evidence do we have that the investment has improved learning for our kids? And then thinking about this aspect of scaling the work, you know, a lot of times when I go into schools, you know, I'll see a few teachers using the devices effectively or a few administrators that can really articulate how those devices should be used to get kids to think and apply their thinking. But many times I see devices not being used or the kids are just watching videos. And this is not being negative. This is just based on what I see. So when we think about how we avoid some of the dangers of putting the cart before the horse, there has to be a shared vision, shared expectations, common language, so that as we utilize or as the kids utilize devices in the classrooms, that it really is purposeful. And also, you know, one last thought as we think about this concept of, you know, avoiding these dangers is making sure that when devices are being used, there's the instructional component, that's what the teacher does, but more importantly, the learning component, and that's what the kids do. You know, as we put the devices in the hands of our learners in our schools, it's not what the adult does with the technology that matters. It's what our kids do with it. How are our kids using it to construct new knowledge? How are they using technology to demonstrate conceptual mastery? How are kids using technology to learn in ways that they couldn't without it? How are they able to creatively report out, to reflect on their learning, to share across relevant contexts and multiple disciplines? A lot of questions to ask. But in summary, make sure the training and support is there before we invest in devices. If not, put it in place now. Make sure it's aligned to relevant research. Make sure that there's a feedback loop, that there is accountability, that you're reflecting. Because ultimately, the devices can support enhanced learning, but it's incumbent upon us to avoid the dangers. And we can ill afford to automatically think that putting a device in the hands of kids is going to translate to learning. Thanks, everybody.